In the 18th century, England experienced a renaissance in the arts, philosophy, and religion. And its statesmen had tremendous influence worldwide. England reaped the vast fortune of its colonies, the Caribbean, India, and the American colonies. The eyes of the world were on the American colonies. For 150 years after 1607, the colonies had enjoyed unusual freedom in managing their own affairs. Unlike in England, they were able to determine their own fate in the areas of political, religious, social, and financial beliefs. The colonies were experiencing great prosperity. The French-Indian War had opened up the Ohio Valley, and the colonists began a westward movement. Plantations in the southern colonies were producing tobacco, indigo, and rice for export. Boston, New York, and Philadelphia had become influential areas of commerce, and New England was the center for whaling and lumber trade. The tall ships that were sailing throughout the world were being made by colonial craftsmen. Because of the distance from England, the British rose with the continental fighting with the French. The colonies prospered under the neglect of the British government. The American colonists experienced a higher standard of living than any other group of colonists. The British government had a difficult time understanding the American attitude that they were doing fine on their own and were capable of making the best possible decisions. By the early 1770s, the majority of colonists viewed the English as relatives who were meddling in their affairs. The colonists were tired of the unfair laws, taxes, and constant display of British troops in American soil. The colony of Massachusetts led the other colonies in anti-British activity. This was the home of the famous leaders John Adams, Samuel Adams, John Hancock, and Dr. Joseph Warren. These men had a large following and were very, very vocal against the British. It was a tremendous blow to the colonists when England announced in 1763 that it had no choice but to tax the colonies to help England pay for its war debt due to the war with France. The colonies were told that their primary obligation was to help the mother country. Unfortunately, the colonists did not see eye to eye with the British. The Americans were angry and communicated to the British government that in no uncertain terms were they willing to pay taxes without representation. The Americans had no say in what Parliament decided for the colonies. The Americans believed that while Parliament could legislate for the colonies, taxes were a gift to the government from the people and could only be levied through their direct representatives in Parliament, and the colonies didn't have a single representative. This was the beginning of the troubles England was going to have with the colonies. The battle cry had been sounded. Americans refused to send their goods to Britain so that they would have to pay duty taxes. The colonists were enraged and began to harass the tax collectors. The number of discontented colonists swelled, and the British finally began to realize that they were going to have to make some concessions, or there was going to be an uprising by the American colonists. Parliament repealed all the duties except the one for tea. England had passed a law changing the way tea was sold to the colonies. The Tea Act, as it was called, claimed that only the East India Company, a British-owned company, could sell tea to the colonists. This had been very big business to the Americans, and this was the straw that broke the camel's back. The colonists refused to comply, and the Boston colonists took extreme action and dumped all the tea into the Boston Harbor on a very cold December morning in 1773. Other cities followed, and the British pulled in the reins on the colonists. Parliament decided to punish the people of Massachusetts by passing an act that totally closed down the port. England was beginning to feel very nervous toward the colonies and sent thousands of soldiers to keep law and order. Parliament initiated more acts to limit the freedom of the colonists. The Americans told the British that in no uncertain terms would they be treated as secondary citizens of the crown. They said their colonial assemblies had the same stature as Parliament, and they alone would determine the laws or the colonies. The colonies felt that since they didn't interfere with Parliament governing England, that Parliament had no grounds to dictate to them. The colonists still were loyal to the Crown as long as they were allowed to manage their own affairs. A Continental Congress was called to meet in Philadelphia in September 1771 to begin to plan some defensive strategies. The groundwork was laid. It was just a matter of time until the powder keg of emotions exploded. The English began to position themselves and reassigned General Thomas Gage, the commander-in-chief of the British troops, as the governor of Massachusetts. The colonists also began to prepare themselves for the possibility of battle. Each colonial town had its own militia, but they were not well organized and only met once a year for training. The colonists now began training on a monthly basis. Their goal was to be ready in a minute's notice. Hence, the name for these soldiers was the Minutemen. In the winter of 1775, the British found out that the colonists had been hiding weapons and ammunition in small towns. On April 14th, General Gage received a letter from Britain demanding that he take action against the colonists. General Gage told Colonel Francis Smith to organize British soldiers and lead a march on Concord. On the evening of April 18th, Smith had his troops leave Boston in small boats to work their way up to Concord. The British thought they were sneaking into Lexington and Concord, but unbeknown to them, no sooner had they left Boston than two couriers, Paul Revere, a silversmith, and William Dawes, a cordwainer, rode nonstop to Lexington and Concord by different roads to sound the alarm that the British were coming to capture the supplies. Paul Revere reached Lexington first and stopped to warn Samuel Adams and John Hancock, two militant leaders who were hiding from the British. Paul Revere was captured by a British patrol, but Dawes was able to continue to warn people along the way to Concord. The immortal poem, Paul Revere's Ride, by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, tells us the story of Paul Revere's midnight ride. The American Revolution began in Lexington and Concord on Wednesday, April 19th, 1775. On that cold day, no one knew that a war which would take years to finish had begun. The morning of April 19th was extremely cold. The early morning fog clung to the hills. On the road, there were British soldiers as far as the eye could see. Between 700 and 800 soldiers marched on this dreary day to Concord to seize and destroy all the artillery and ammunition, provisions, and all other military stores you can find. General Gage was determined to make an example of the American patriots, Samuel Adams and John Hancock, by capturing them and sending them to England, where they would be tried for treason. Not only did he want a military victory, he wanted these two men. Major John Pitcairn led his troops to Lexington, where they met about 70 Minutemen, mostly farmers, who were commanded by Captain John Parker. Pitcairn had warned his troops not to fire unless the colonists shoot first. But somehow, in all the confusion of the meeting, someone fired the shot that was heard all around the world. And the Revolutionary War had begun. It was never made clear which side fired the shot. However, speculation has it that the shot was fired by the colonists because it was to their advantage to start the war. Some colonists believed that it was Samuel Adams who fired the first shot. Supposedly, he was hiding in a grove of trees near the meeting point of these two sides. The American colonists quickly regrouped and were organizing in each of the colonies. Military supplies were hidden, and the British returned to Boston after failing in their mission. General Gage was unable to leave the colonists defenseless, and he failed in capturing Samuel Adams and John Hancock. Hancock and Adams went to Philadelphia to participate in the Second Continental Congress, which convened in May 1775. The colonist ranks had swollen to 3,000 militia soldiers. Massachusetts enlisted the help of General Artemus Ward to command the Massachusetts troops. Captain Benedict Arnold was also commissioned from the Connecticut militia to raise an army of 400 men from western Massachusetts to capture the British Fort Ticonderoga on Lake Champlain in Upper New York. While preparing for the attack, Captain Arnold found out that Ethan Allen and his Green Mountain Boys were also planning an attack on the fort. They combined forces and in May captured it. Along with the fort came 78 pieces of heavy artillery. These guns would eventually be used to drive the British out of the colonies. All of Gage's worst fears had been realized. The rebels were not going to be stopped until they ran out of men to fight the British soldiers. Neither side was willing to label the battles as full-blown war. However, it was obvious that both sides were stalemated. It became apparent to the British government that Gage needed help in controlling the colonies. Three major generals were sent to Boston: William Howe, John Burgoyne, and Henry Clinton. All three men were much younger than Gage and veterans of the Seven Years' War. On June 12, 1775, under the advice of the three men, Gage declared martial law. Gage called their New England militia and their British sympathizers as rebels and traitors. 1,100 British reinforcements arrived, and the generals decided to seize Dorchester Heights near Boston. On June 13th, the rebels got wind of the British plans. The Rebel Council of War determined that they would first fortify Bunker Hill east of Charleston and north of Boston. The colonists now had an army of approximately 1,200 soldiers. It was decided that the soldiers would dig a trench on Breed's Hill because it was closer to Boston. In the middle of the night, the colonist soldiers began digging a trench 40 feet square. As dawn broke, the British soldiers discovered the trench and opened fire on the American soldiers. The British generals met in a council of war to discuss their plans of attack. It was decided to mount a frontal attack. British troops were on board warships waiting for high tide so they could sneak ashore and catch the soldiers in the trench by surprise. Gage, Clinton, Howe, and Burgoyne developed an elaborate plan. The generals were surprised to see that the colonists held their own in this battle. The generals began to panic when, after hours of battle, the rebels still did not fold lines of battle. More British soldiers were brought from the ships. They continued to fight late into the day when the Americans were finally driven back. Both sides paid dearly for the battle. The British losses were great. Over 40% of the men were either killed or wounded. There were 1,100 British soldiers killed and 828 wounded. The American losses were about 400 killed, 271 wounded, and 30 taken prisoner. The Americans felt that although they deeply regretted their losses, they were astonished that they had given the British a run for their money. Even General Gage said that these people show a spirit and conduct against us they never showed against the French. They are now spirited up by a rage and enthusiasm as great as ever people were possessed of, and must proceed in earnest or give the business up. The loss we have sustained is greater than we can bear. After the battle at Breed's Hill, the British made no effort to move for a year. During the rest of 1775 and through the winter of 1776, they made no effort to break out of the siege that confined them to Boston, especially since they were outnumbered by the American forces. The British would be engaged in numerous battles with the American rebels, but they would never act with the same speed and aggressiveness that was seen at Bunker Hill. Early in July, George Washington arrived in Cambridge, Massachusetts, to take command, not of an army, but of a loosely disciplined group of men, numbering over 14,000. Only the Rhode Island troops had tents. The others were quartered in Harvard's dormitories, in private houses, and some soldiers made shelters. The army had no uniforms. The men wore their farming or working clothes, and just added a sword or hung ammunition belts across their shoulders. Washington was appalled, but also amazed as to what these unorganized and underfed men accomplished. In his report to Congress, he showed that he realized how they had done it. The deficiencies in their numbers, he wrote, their discipline and stores can only lead to this conclusion that their spirits had exceeded their strength. Washington knew it'd be no easy task to discipline, organize, and train an army of this size. He needed time, and the British were willing to oblige him. He secured rifles, supplies, and drilled the men. He weeded out cowards and lazy men who would not make good soldiers. Since they were still entrenched, the British had no burning desire to tangle with the colonists. They were waiting patiently for reinforcements from Britain. In September, Gage was recalled, and Howe became the commander of the British forces. Howe was handsome and very heavy, and was fond of good living and of gambling, and was very open about having a mistress. While Washington was busy training his men, the Congress received word that Sir Guy Carleton, military governor of Canada, was making preparations to invade these colonies and instigating the Indian nations to take up the hatchet against them. For many years, the Canadian province had been both a threat and a temptation to the colonists. New Englanders had closely watched the French as they used rivers and lakes from the St. Lawrence to the Hudson as an avenue of invasion. Now they feared that the British would use these waterways to separate the New England colonies from the middle colonies. There were influential colonists who believed that the Canadians wanted to join the other colonies. So, in late June, Congress ordered General Philip Schuyler to proceed to Ticonderoga and Crown Point, and if possible, take Montreal and any other parts of the country. Schuyler was very slow in organizing. He failed to enlist enough troops until late in August, while his more energetic second-in-command, Brigadier General Richard Montgomery, quickly launched the expedition from Crown Point without him. While this force was proceeding to Ticonderoga, Washington came up with another plan. Why not send another column at the same time to attack Quebec, just 150 miles down the St. Lawrence from Montreal? If the two cities were attacked simultaneously, Carleton would be at a serious disadvantage and in all probability could not defend both. A practicable route seemed to be open at the Kennebec River, then along the Dead River to Lake Megantic and down the Chaudière to where it met the St. Lawrence, within 4 miles of Quebec. For this mission, he selected 1,050 volunteers and picked riflemen under the command of Colonel Benedict Arnold. Schuyler lays siege to St. John's September 6th, then, because of illness, relinquished command to Montgomery, an extremely able officer. The garrison capitulated November 2nd, but Carleton escaped with the remnants of his small force to Quebec, thereby uncovering Montreal, which the Americans occupied on November 13th. Arnold's column, after suffering incredible hardships through brutal terrain and weather, reached the outskirts of Quebec November 9th. By now, the force consisted of only about 600 gaunt, ragged men, their clothing torn to pieces, hung in strips. Few had any shoes but moccasins made of raw skin. Many without hats, beards long, and visages thin and meager. Montgomery, with 300 men, joined Arnold, and on December 31st, they attacked the walled city in a snowstorm, only to have the assault end in disaster when Montgomery was killed and Arnold wounded. Arnold, however, refused to give up. He appealed to Congress for reinforcements and decided to keep the remnants of his force around the city for the winter. A heroic gesture, perhaps, but a foolhardy one, fraught with suffering and danger for his men. Carleton was well supplied to withstand a winter siege, and with the coming of spring and more British troops, he would have little difficulty in driving the Americans away. In the meantime, Arnold's men suffered cruelly from the weather, smallpox, and hunger. The natives refused to feed them, and Arnold admitted that our credit extends no farther than our arms. The result was that the men plundered priest and peasant alike, despite Washington's order to the contrary. Thus, the attempt to win the support of the Canadians to the American cause was doomed. King George, meanwhile, refused even to receive the so-called Olive Branch petition forced through the Congress by the Conservatives, which affirmed their loyalty to the King, but reiterated the grievances of the colonies and begged the Crown to prevent further hostilities until such compromise could be worked out. Instead, the King now proclaimed all the colonies to be in open rebellion and prohibited all commerce with them, effective March 1st, 1776. These actions, of course, considerably strengthened the hands of the radicals. "Now," wrote Jefferson, "we want neither inducement nor power to declare and assert separation. It is a will alone that is wanting, and that is growing apace under the fostering hand of our King." Something soon came to build much of the will necessary in the form of a 47-page pamphlet entitled Common Sense, showing once again that perhaps the pen can be mightier than the sword. Written by Thomas Paine, a 38-year-old English immigrant, it was published in Philadelphia in January 1776, and within 3 months had sold over 100,000 copies, a phenomenal sale in that day and age. Despite its title, it appealed to the emotions rather than to reason, and was not aimed primarily at the educated people. Paine had the ability to speak in the language of the ordinary colonist. He pleaded the cause of independence by ridiculing the theory of the divine right of kings, thus undermining respect for the crown, by then really the last tenuous tie with the mother country. Even more important than his ridiculing of kings was his clear call for immediate independence. "Everything that is right or reasonable pleads for separation. The blood of the slain, the weeping voice of nature cries, 'Tis time to part.'" This was the message that spread throughout the colonies, the message that Congress, with all its petitions and resolutions, had not been able to get across to the ordinary colonists. Then, as if the idea of independence needed further stimulation, Parliament proceeded to give it the final push. It passed an act removing the colonies from the protection of the crown and authorizing the seizure and confiscation of all American ships at sea. Passed in December 1775, news of it reached Philadelphia at the end of February and drew the delegates into consternation. The radicals, of course, were delighted at the additional blunder. The mother country herself had now cut the colonies off and practically declared war. By now, it was evident to the British government that the plans for subduing the American colonies would have to be conceived on a much grander scale than had been at first anticipated. The strategy of simple seizure of certain towns and cities along the coast, which could be done because of the British control of the sea, or of burning towns and dispersing small bands of ragged rebels, would not crush the revolt. Instead, a much broader plan was now developed. The decision was to divide the colonies and conquer them in big chunks in order to isolate the three general areas. That is, the New England colonies, the Middle colonies, and the Southern colonies. Three large columns would do this, one moving south from Canada, another sweeping north from the Carolinas, and the third thrusting through New York and Pennsylvania, and then splitting north and south to unite with the other two columns. It was a simple divide and conquer strategy that should have been successful. Its failure lay in lack of overall support and coordination on both the political and military levels, and a critical underestimation of the ability and determination of the rebels on the part of the individual British field commanders. The first move in this plan was made January 20th, when Clinton sailed from Boston with a force he vaguely estimated at between 1,200 and 1,500. He was to rendezvous off Cape Fear, North Carolina, with another command under General Lord Charles Cornwallis, and Admiral Peter Parker to be sent from Ireland. Originally headed for Charleston, South Carolina, the expedition changed its destination to Cape Fear because Governor Josiah Martin of North Carolina convinced the British that with the help of a few British regiments, he could raise enough loyalists to put down the rebellion in North Carolina first. And this, he claimed, would facilitate the capture of South Carolina and Georgia. Martin based his hopes of raising a large force primarily on a relatively new group of immigrants, the so-called Highland Scots, who had made small settlements in several coastal counties. They had fought for the Stuarts against the House of Hanover in 1745, and after their bloody defeat at Culloden, had found refuge in the New World. Although they had no love for the Hanoverian George III, they had still less for more settlers in the Piedmont area, many of whom were the so-called Lowland or Scotch-Irish immigrants. Thus, by 1775, North Carolina was generally split into two groups. The Patriots, consisting primarily of the Scotch-Irish and other settlers of the Piedmont, who favored independence from the crown, and the Loyalists or Tories, primarily the crown officials, wealthy merchants and planters, conservatives, and Scots Highlanders who favored loyalty to the king at any price. The fleet from Ireland was supposed to sail in December, but in fact did not leave until the middle of February, as communications between Britain, General Howe, and Governor Martin were necessarily slow and unreliable. The governor decided to start raising his army without waiting for the arrivals of the British troops. By February 15th, he had about 700 Highlanders and 800 other loyalists under the command of 80-year-old Donald MacDonald, an experienced soldier and general in the militia. But as soon as word of the loyalist activities leaked out, the Patriots began gathering their forces under Colonel James Moore of the 1st North Carolina Regiment. Moore raised about 1,000 volunteers and Minutemen and decided to contest the Loyalist march to the coast to join the Redcoats at Moore's Creek Bridge, about 20 miles above Wilmington. In the misty dawn of February 27th, with drums beating and bagpipes skirling, the Highland Scots, some dressed in plaids and kilts, rushed the bridge, swinging the terrible claymores and screaming their battle cry, King George and Broadswords. They were met by a withering fire at point-blank range as rebel rifles flashed and cracked in the pale gray light. Almost the whole advance party was cut down. In less than 5 minutes, the Loyalist force was in complete retreat, which quickly turned into a rout as the rebels promptly mounted a counterattack. In the next few days, they captured over 800 Loyalists, almost destroying the small army and preventing the rendezvous with the British. Although not realized at the time, this victory did much more than merely check the growth of Loyalist sentiments in the colony. It fanned the fires of revolutionary fervor to such a pitch that on April 12th, North Carolina instructed its delegation to the Second Continental Congress in Philadelphia to vote for independence, the first colony to do so. It also thwarted the plan, the British invasion of North Carolina. With the British force finally arrived off Cape Fear, it moved on to the original destination of Charleston. During the winter, Washington had whipped his force into a fairly respectable army, and by March, it numbered about 16,000 men. He now desired to take some offensive action before the British could be reinforced in the spring. His officers agreed, but believing the army was not strong enough to attack Boston, it was decided to occupy and fortify Dorchester Heights. By this maneuver, they hoped to force the British either to attack or evacuate. The necessary artillery for such action was available, General Henry Knox having it hauled laboriously by hand overland from Fort Ticonderoga during the winter. On March 4th, under cover of darkness, and artillery flare, General John Thomas moved onto the heights with 2,000 men and quickly threw up prefabricated fortifications, picks and shovels being useless on the frozen ground. By day, the job was complete. The rebels have done more in one night than my whole army could do in months, Howe is reported to have remarked when he viewed the fortifications. Realizing he would have to attack or evacuate, and with the memory of Bunker Hill still fresh in his mind, Howe chose the latter. By March 17th, the British had sailed for Halifax, taking about 1,000 loyalists with them. Washington, however, was not deceived by this move. He anticipated that Howe's next attack would be against New York City, and he immediately moved his small army there. It is the place that we must use every endeavor to keep from them, he wrote, for should they get that town and the command of the North River, they can stop the intercourse between the northern and southern colonies, upon which depends the safety of America. Once in New York, he put all available labor to work digging entrenchments and erecting forts, redoubts, and batteries. While Washington was thus engaged that spring, Clinton was finally joined by Cornwallis and Parker off Charleston early in May. Although ordered to join Howe later in New York, Clinton decided to attack Charleston before he sailed north. The entrance to the harbor was protected by forts on two islands, Fort Johnson on James Island and Fort Sullivan, later called Fort Moultrie, on Sullivan's Island. The latter fort, however, was only about half built and consisted of nothing more than palmetto logs and sand, with the rear virtually open and undefended. Here on June 28th, Colonel Moultrie and about 400 South Carolinians withstood the fire of over 100 British naval guns and beat back Parker's attack of three ships of the line, damaging all of them and inflicting over 200 casualties on the British. Clinton also failed miserably when he tried to support Parker's naval attack. He landed most of his troops on the Long Island, later named Isle of Palms, near Sullivan's Island, and separated from it by a channel called the Breach, which Clinton was led to believe was only 18 inches deep. But when he tried to storm the rear of Fort Sullivan, he discovered to his chagrin that in places the water was 7 feet deep, and under a heavy fire, he withdrew and abandoned the attempt. By nightfall, it was all over, and the British force later sailed for New York. The Americans had suffered only about 32 casualties. This humiliating British defeat, coupled with the failure of the Loyalists at Moore's Creek, kept the southern colonies free of British control for the next 3 years, enabling the rebels to send men and supplies to the middle colonies to support the American cause. If the news from the south was encouraging, that from the north was not. In April, Arnold's small force, which had spent the terrible winter in front of Quebec, was finally reinforced by Congress with enough troops to bring its strength up to 2,000. And in May, General John Thomas, a capable, energetic officer, was placed in command. Thomas immediately realized that the little army, racked by disease and desertions, was in no condition to conduct a siege. He ordered a retreat. While this move was underway, Carleton, now reinforced by regular troops from England, sailed out with a force of about 900 men and drove the Americans south in panic, a disorganized mob with little trace of any military system. Without order or regularity, eating up provisions as fast as they were brought in. By early July, they were back on American soil at Fort Ticonderoga, and Montreal and Quebec were safe in British hands. Despite this failure of the Canadian campaign, it did achieve one of Washington's main objectives in delaying for over a year a British buildup for an invasion south. As Washington had predicted, Howe's main objective now became the middle colonies. His immediate goal was New York City, which he hoped to use as his major base for conquest of the colonies. Reinforcements arrived steadily. Within a week, 130 ships of war and transports disembarked over 9,000 troops. On July 12th, Admiral Richard Howe, brother of the general, arrived with a fleet of 150 ships crowded with soldiers fresh from England. A little later, Parker arrived from Charleston with 2,500 men under Clinton and Cornwallis. In August, they were joined by 8,000 German Hessians. Howe's total force now consisted of approximately 32,000 well-disciplined professional soldiers, fully armed, equipped, and supplied. This was the largest expeditionary force England had ever dispatched. On July 2nd, after months of violent disagreements and debates, the Congress passed a resolution that these United Colonies are, and of right, ought to be free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiances to the British Crown, and that all political connection between them and the state of Great Britain is and ought to be totally dissolved. Introduced by Richard Henry Lee of Virginia and seconded by John Adams of Massachusetts, it was a fitting climax to the long alliance between Virginia and Massachusetts in the quest for independence. The die was now cast. There could be no turning back. What was needed now was a formal document to proclaim the fact to the world and, at the same time, justify and explain the necessity for this world-shaking event. Thomas Jefferson had drafted a declaration, and July 3rd and 4th were spent discussing it. The Congress went over it carefully, paragraph by paragraph, changing a word here, a sentence there, striking out this, adding that. The members rejected completely a severe censure of the people of Great Britain, and they struck out Jefferson's caustic condemnation of the slave trade. In late afternoon, July 4th, the amended declaration passed, although it would not be signed by the members until a later date. In 1778, Washington was empowered to raise a company of 400 Indians for use as scouts and raiders, and at least one red man died in winter quarters at Valley Forge after fighting for his country. The Indians, particularly the Iroquois, were a major factor in the tenuous Northwest country during the war, and though most fought with the British and paid dearly for it during the after war, many joined with the colonists in their mutual fight. At the same time, a number of the 2,000 Jews in America during the Revolution made their contribution. Francis Salvador of Charleston, South Carolina, died in the first year of the war. In 1777, Mordecai Sheftal became Commissioner General of Purchases and Issues for the Georgia Militia. And throughout the war, Haim Salomon helped the fledgling nation finance its way to the independence. Of course, the American Negro, free and slave, played a large part in the Revolution. Peter Salem and other black soldiers fought at Bunker Hill, and Salem himself is credited with killing Major Pitcairn. Though Congress had barred Negroes from enlistment in the Continental Army in October 1775, Washington ordered the black recruits be accepted, and the Congress backed down on the issue. Many white slaveholders under the substitute provisions sent their slaves into the army in their place. But by far, the majority of the blacks who fought were freedmen who did so of their own choosing. Over 5% of Washington's army at Monmouth were Negro soldiers, and the Continental forces generally averaged about 50 black troops in every battalion. Two of these men, Prince Whipple and Oliver Cromwell, were by Washington's side when he crossed the Delaware on Christmas 1776. With the exception of two all-black regiments, one from Rhode Island and one from Massachusetts, Negro soldiers were not segregated in the army. Of course, there were widespread opposition to their service, predominantly from the northern slave traders and southern plantation owners. But the blacks proved themselves in battle. A few, like Edward Griffin of North Carolina, were freed by state edict in return for their services. In one battle alone during the withdrawal of Sullivan from Newport, the newly formed Black Regiment from Rhode Island, 400 strong, withstood three furious assaults by some 1,500 Hessians. While the men were fighting, the women of the Revolution cooked, nursed, ran hospitals, sewed, raised supplies and money, and suffered hardship and privation for the cause. Many followed their husbands in the army, making life in war a little more tolerable by preparing meals for soldiers. Others spent their time within sight and sound of the enemy, spying and carrying information back to the rebels. They melted their pewter into bullets and made their bedding into clothing. Mrs. David Wright of Groton, Massachusetts, was elected sergeant of a company of soldiers' wives who banded together after their husbands went off to war. These minute women captured at least one Tory and provided information to Continental authorities. And of course, there were the numerous Molly Pitchers of real and legendary fame, like Mary Hayes, who manned a cannon at Monmouth, and Molly Corbin, who took her dying husband's place at the gun in the defense of Fort Washington. Whatever their mode of service, the women of colonial America did their part and more for the winning of independence. Washington realized that the key to the defense of Manhattan lay beyond the limits of the island. Directly across the East River was Long Island, the village of Brooklyn, and more important, Brooklyn Heights, which rose 100 feet above the river, a situation very similar to Dorchester Heights and Boston. Whoever occupied Brooklyn Heights would control the river and most of New York. Here, Washington had a series of forts and strong earthworks constructed. About a mile and a half south of these fortifications was another ridge of hills called the Heights of Guam, which formed a natural barrier protecting the defenses of Brooklyn Heights. General Putnam, in command, placed about 3,000 of his 10,000 men along this line under the immediate command of General John Sullivan, a mediocre officer. Putnam knew practically nothing about the topography of the island, and as a result, his disposition of troops was extremely faulty. By late August, Howe was ready to move. From the 22nd to the 25th, he landed about 22,000 troops unopposed at Gravesend at the tip of Long Island. Then, under cover of darkness, the night of the 26th, he moved the bulk of his force in an all-night march around the left flank of the American advance line, leaving the rest to demonstrate against the American center and right. At the same time, he ordered Admiral Howell to sail his warships up the river to bombard the Brooklyn fortifications and cut off a possible retreat route for the rebels. The move caught the Americans completely by surprise, and by noon the next day, Howe had swept the ridge clear of all rebels, who fled in panic back to the fortifications at Brooklyn, suffering about 1,500 casualties to the Britishers' 377. Fortunately for the American cause, a stiff north wind and a swift ebbing tide prevented Admiral Howe from sailing his flotilla of warships up the East River to within supporting distance of the land forces. Had he succeeded, it is entirely possible that the whole American army might have been killed or captured, and the revolution brought to an end right there. By late afternoon, all who escaped death or capture were safely within the fortified lines of Brooklyn Heights. Washington, who had been in the field since early morning, now sent to New York for reinforcements. Anxiously, the disheartened Americans waited for the expected concentrated attack, but it never came. Instead, Howe drew back and halted, then began preparations for a regular siege approach, to the utter consternation of many of his officers. Howe apparently was still scared by the memory of Bunker Hill. One of his officers recorded in his journal the bitterness and frustration many of them felt at this critical failure to continue the attack. Far from taking the rash resolution of hastily passing over the East River and crushing at once a frightened, trembling enemy, He generously gave them time to recover from their panic, to throw up fresh works, to make new arrangements, and to recover from the torpid state the rebellion appeared from its last shock. All the next day, Howell still did not move. That afternoon, a cold northeaster blew up and pelted the hapless and hungry Americans. "We had no tents to screen us from its pitiless pelting," wrote an officer. "For food, all they had was hard biscuits and pickled pork, eaten raw because fires were impossible in the downpour." Despite their sufferings, however, nature really helped the rebels, for the storms kept the British fleet out of the East River and left an avenue of retreat open if needed. Finally realizing his precarious position on the morning of the 29th, Washington ordered his officers to New York to gather all boats fit for transporting troops and to assemble them by dark. The handling of these boats was entrusted to Colonel John Glover's regiment of Marblehead, Massachusetts fishermen. During the night, the retreat began. A Connecticut major described what happened. "To move so large a body of troops, with all their necessary appendages, across a river full a mile wide, with a rapid current, in face of a victorious, well-disciplined army nearly three times as numerous as his own, and a fleet capable of stopping the navigation so that not one boat could have passed over, seemed to present most formidable obstacles. But in the face of these difficulties, the commander-in-chief so arranged his business that on the evening of the 29th by 10 o'clock, the troops began to retire from the lines in such a manner that no chasm was made in the lines. But as one regiment left their station on guard, the remaining troops moved to the right and left and filled up the vacancies, while General Washington took his station at the ferry and superintended the embarkation of the troops. It was one of the most anxious, busy nights I ever recollect, and being the third in which hardly any of us had closed our eyes in sleep, we were all greatly fatigued. In the face of a complete disaster, Washington succeeded in extricating 9,500 men with all their supplies and equipment from under Howe's very nose. The noted English historian Trevelyan stated it was a master stroke of energy, dexterity, and caution by which Washington saved his army and his country. This brilliant stroke was undoubtedly crucial to the patriotic cause, as after the defeat on the 27th and the chance of complete annihilation, the morale of the Americans had been shattered. One officer observed, "If independence had not been declared before the battle of the 27th, it is the opinion of the writer that it would not have been declared." This was apparently Howe's belief also, because instead of vigorously pursuing Washington, he now delayed several vital weeks while he sent General Sullivan, who had been captured, to Congress to suggest an informal peace conference to discuss reconciliation. Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, and Edmund Rutledge were appointed to meet with Howe. The conference was held on Staten Island, September 11th, but when Howe insisted the revocation of the resolution of independence was a necessary prelude to any peace negotiations, the meeting broke up. Had independence not been declared, it is highly probable that the rebellion would have ended then and there. After the failure of the peace conference, Washington, realizing that the British occupation of Brooklyn Heights made his position on Lower Manhattan untenable, immediately started a withdrawal to a new line on Harlem Heights. For a change, Howe reacted quickly and almost succeeded in capturing a large part of the American army with a surprise landing at Kipps Bay on the rebel left flank, September 15th. But the withdrawal continued, and Washington succeeded in consolidating his forces on the strong natural defensive terrain of the Heights, where he established a three-line defense in depth. The next day, the British advance party made a weak attack, which was quickly repulsed, while the rebels continued to erect strong entrenchments. Again, Howe had no stomach for attacking the rebels behind fortifications. Instead, he planned once more to outflank them. During the night of October 12th, he embarked the bulk of his army, sailed up the East River and Long Island Sound, and landed at Pell's Point in Westchester. This move imperiled the American army. Consequently, Washington moved to White Plains, leaving strong garrisons under General Nathanael Greene in Fort Washington and Fort Lee across the river on the Palisades in New Jersey. The rebels formed a 3-mile-wide line through the village of White Plains, but unfortunately neglected to fortify a strategic elevation on their right. When Howe attacked October 28th and seized the hill, Washington was forced to withdraw to a new position 5 miles north of Newcastle. While Washington was thus engaged in striving to keep his little army intact, another threat developed on the American Northern Front. After driving the rebels out of Canada, Carleton had been reinforced to about 13,000, including German mercenaries and Indians, but he was not ready to move south until September. The key to his success was control of Lake Champlain, which both he and Arnold, in command of naval operations on the lake, realized. While Carleton was building and assembling gunboats and sailing vessels, Arnold, who knew something about boats from his experience as a West Indies trader, succeeded under almost impossible conditions in getting about 15 ships of various types built and manned by motley crews, most of them inexperienced. October 11th to 13th, the two forces met at Valcour Bay, and Carleton's experienced sailors and superior equipment swept the little American flotilla from the lake. But the delay this caused Carleton was decisive. He concluded he was now not prepared for a winter campaign, and instead of laying siege to Fort Ticonderoga and coming down the Hudson to join Howe, he retreated back into Canada for the winter, an action which undoubtedly helped save the American cause. Howe now changed his tactics. Instead of pursuing the main American forces, he turned south, and on November 16th, attacked isolated Fort Washington with about 8,000 men. Although Washington had advised Greene to evacuate the fort, Greene, as yet inexperienced, chose to keep the garrison there, and when it was forced to surrender, the Americans lost over 2,800 men, most of them captured, while the British suffered only about 450 casualties. Greene and Washington then joined forces at Hackensack and retreated across New Jersey towards the Delaware River, with Cornwallis close at their heels. On December 7th, the rebels crossed the river into Pennsylvania, seizing or destroying all the boats they could find. After his unsuccessful chase, Cornwallis stopped at the Delaware as the British advance bogged down. As we go forward into the country, the rebels fly before us, a British officer noted. And when we come back, they always follow us. 'Tis almost impossible to catch them. They will neither fight nor totally run away, but they keep at such a distance that we are always a day's march from them. Howe then declared his campaign at the end of the winter and sent the bulk of his force back to New York, leaving garrisons at Trenton, Princeton, and Bordentown, with a supply base at New Brunswick. It seemed, as winter approached after a year and a half of war, that Washington had achieved his big objective, the preservation of his army. So long as Washington and that army existed, the rebellion would go on, regardless of what territory the British might control. But, in fact, the army was on the verge of collapse. Desertions, disease, lack of supplies, and apathy on the part of the Congress and the people of the colonies threatened to destroy it. a British general wrote to the commander of the Hessian garrison at Trenton that the American army was almost naked, dying of cold, without blankets, and very ill supplied with provisions. It was that December that Thomas Paine, the propagandist of the Revolution, wrote his famous words. These are the times that try men's souls. The summer soldier and the sunshine patriot will, in this crisis, shrink from the service of their country. But he that stands, it now deserves the love and thanks of man and woman. Washington realized in desperation that something had to be done, and done quickly, to restore morale and arouse interest in the cause of freedom. He decided on a surprise attack on the ill-prepared force at Trenton. Christmas night, he led about 2,400 men across the ice-choked Delaware in a blinding snow and sleet storm, and early the next morning attacked the sleeping Hessians in two columns. The surprise was complete. In less than an hour, almost 1,000 Hessians were captured or killed, while the rebels suffered only 5 casualties. The Patriot cause now looked to new hope, and enlistment started to pick up. An American officer observed, "Never were men in higher spirits than our whole army is." Howe reacted quickly to this embarrassing defeat. He ordered Cornwallis into Jersey with heavy reinforcements to crush the small rebel force. Cornwallis reached Trenton January 2nd, but then rejected the advice of his officers to attack at once, stating that he could do just as well bag the fox the next morning, to which one of his officers replied, "My lord, if you trust those people tonight, you will see nothing of them in the morning." Leaving his campfire burning and just enough men to give the appearance of an occupied camp, Washington stole around Cornwallis's flank, and by dawn was close to Princeton, where he routed a British force coming up to join his antagonist. Hearing the sound of battle in his rear, Cornwallis fell back to Brunswick to protect his supply base, and Washington led his exhausted troops into winter quarters in the hills around Morristown. With these two quick victories, Washington had cleared all but eastern New Jersey of British troops, but more important, he had restored the shattered morale of the Americans. A British civilian noted that now volunteer companies are collecting in every county on the continent, and in a few months the rascals will be stronger than ever. Even the parsons, some of them have turned out as volunteers and pulpit drums of thunder, when you please to call it, summoning all arms in this cursed bobble. Damn them all. Although these volunteers and the state militia were a vital element, indeed, the war could not have been won without them. It was almost impossible for Washington to make any long-range plans concerning them. Most of the volunteers came to fight one or two battles near their homes and then disappeared again. In too many cases, the state militia were a little better. Prior to 1775, nearly every able-bodied man between 16 and 50 served in the militia, organized primarily for defense against the Indians, and in some places the French. Most of the time, however, it was more a social club than a military organization. Usually the enlisted men elected their officers and disposed of them in like manner. Strict military discipline was practically unknown. Oftentimes their enlistments were for 3, 6, or 9 months, and when their term expired, they promptly took off for home, regardless of the military situation or the wishes of their officers. Consequently, they could not be consistently relied upon. By spring of 1777, the Patriot Army was up to over 10,000 men and in relatively good condition. Then Howe surprised Washington by withdrawing all his troops to New York, with the exception of a small force at Amboy. During the winter, the British ministry had approved a new plan for conquering New York and isolating the New England states. A strong force commanded by General John Burgoyne would push down Lake Champlain and the Hudson River. A secondary force consisting primarily of loyalists and Indians, would operate from Oswego through the Mohawk Valley, and a large detachment from Howe's army would move up the Hudson and join Burgoyne at Albany. This was an excellent plan, but the ministry also approved at the same time Howe's plan to capture Philadelphia, in the mistaken belief that he could accomplish that and still join Burgoyne in time. On June 17th, Burgoyne moved south from Canada with a force of 9,400 men, including British and German troops, Canadians, Loyalists, and Indians. July 6th, he captured Fort Ticonderoga and substantial American supplies. Moving on quickly, Burgoyne continued his advance south. But then things began to go wrong for the British. Rough terrain and the laying tactics of General Philip John Schuyler's troops, who felled trees, destroyed bridges, and burned crops, slowed his progress and strained his supplies. The secondary force coming through the Mohawk Valley stopped to besiege Fort Stanwix. But when they learned that Arnold was a force of about 1,000 was coming to the fort's support, they retreated back into Canada. To make matters worse, Howe was not coming from New York. On July 23rd, he set sail for Philadelphia with 1,500 troops, leaving Clinton to hold New York with a small force. By early August, Burgoyne's supply situation was critical. Learning of a large store of American supplies at Bennington, Vermont, he sent a detachment of about 800 to seize it. But an aroused band of New England militia, alarmed by stories of Indian atrocities, routed this force, as well as reinforcements sent later on August 16th. Inflicting about 1,000 casualties, Burgoyne now had a crucial decision to make. Retreat to Canada or gamble and push on towards Albany. He chose the latter. September 13th, the British crossed to the west bank of the Hudson, and 4 miles north of the village of Stillwater, they came upon the Americans, about 9,000 men, commanded by General Horatio Gates, entrenched in a strong position on Bemis Heights, where the road to Albany passed through a narrow defile. The American position commanded both the road and the river. On September 19th, Burgoyne attacked the rebel left in an attempt to gain some high ground, but was checked short of his objective after a furious day-long fight. The British commander then decided to entrench and await help from Clinton in New York, and for 3 weeks he waited in vain. Clinton did not move up the Hudson, and October 6th captured some forts below Albany, but then decided he needed reinforcements before advancing farther, and retreated back to New York, leaving Burgoyne isolated. Realizing his situation was desperate, Burgoyne tried once more on October 7th to cave in the American left. But when that failed, he retreated northward to the heights around Saratoga. But there, an American force that had now grown to about 20,000 surrounded his hungry troops. On October 17th, he surrendered his entire army, consisting now of only about 6,000 men. This British disaster proved to be the turning point of the war. When news of the American victory reached Europe, France decided to aid the Americans openly by recognizing their independence, entering into a treaty of amity and commerce, and agreeing to a treaty of alliance if and when war broke out between Britain and France. This was the aid and support the Americans had to have in order to achieve independence. Washington, meanwhile, had not fared so well. After finally leaving New York in July, Howe, instead of proceeding directly up the Delaware to Philadelphia, sailed up Chesapeake Bay, and on August 25th, landed at Head of Elk, 55 miles from the city. Washington, with about 11,000 troops, took up a defensive position to block him on the east side of Brandywine Creek. Howe attacked September 11th using a flanking movement similar to that employed in the Battle of Long Island. Washington was routed and forced to withdraw across the Schuylkill River, suffering over 1,000 casualties to about half that number for the British. Congress fled to Lancaster and later to York as the British occupied Philadelphia with their main encampment in Germantown. Washington now planned a surprise attack against Howe at his base in Germantown with a series of complicated maneuvers requiring almost perfect coordination and timing. Under cover of a heavy fog before dawn on the morning of October 4th, he threw two columns at the British center, while another two columns were ordered to attack both flanks simultaneously. Unfortunately, the British were not taken completely by surprise, and when the necessary coordination did not take place, the attack slowed. Then, some American troops, confused in the fog, fired on each other, and the rumor started that the British were in their rear. Panic set in and the attack turned into a disorderly retreat. The Americans suffered over 700 casualties. Despite these two defeats and the loss of Philadelphia, morale was surprisingly high as Washington, in December, led his battered army into winter quarters at Valley Forge on the banks of the Schuylkill. Undoubtedly, the great victory at Saratoga helped, but Washington was to learn that winter encampments for the Continental Army could be even more trying and costly than battles in the field. He had selected this desolate winter quarters for a definite purpose: to protect the citizens of Pennsylvania and New Jersey from the marauding enemy, and at the same time to guard the main road from the South to New England. For this, he was severely criticized by the very people he was trying to protect, many of his officers and members of the Congress. He told them, "My answer is that our hopes are not placed in any particular city or spot of ground, but in preserving a good army furnished with proper necessities, to take advantage of favorable opportunities and master and defeat the enemy piecemeal." But when they arrived at Valley Forge, Washington discovered that Congress and the Quartermaster General had failed to secure and transport the necessary supplies, and the local farmers, mostly loyalists in sympathy, were unwilling to sell their products to the rebels. There was fresh pork aplenty in New Jersey and barrels of flour along the Susquehanna, but the wagons and horses needed to transport these supplies were lacking. Thus, Washington was forced to witness the terrible, tragic sight of his soldiers literally starving and freezing to death in a land of plenty. He wrote to Congress, "I am now convinced that unless some great and capital change suddenly takes place, this army must inevitably be reduced to one or other of these three things: starve, dissolve, or disperse in order to obtain sustenance in the best manner they can." Howe had missed a wonderful opportunity to destroy the Americans. He had made no move all winter to attack the rebels, critically short of food and supplies, although they were only 20 miles from Philadelphia. In May, he was relieved and replaced by Clinton. But Clinton brought orders for the evacuation of Philadelphia, much to the disgust of the local loyalists. With the advent of the French alliance and the threat of the French navy, the British did not want to keep their lines extended so far. So in June, they moved out across New Jersey on the way back to New York. Washington followed, sending a strong force under General Charles Lee ahead to strike Clinton's extended column. Lee attacked on June 28th at Monmouth Courthouse, but badly bungled the affair. Washington arrived just in time to stop a complete rout and succeeded in beating back the British counterattack. Clinton stole away that night and retreated safely to New York. Washington then took up a position at White Plains, just above New York, and waited to see what Clinton would do next. Meanwhile, France and England had declared war, and a French fleet under the Comte d'Estaing with 4,000 troops was sent to support the Americans. Arriving off New York in July, it did not attack the British there because the French ships were much too big to maneuver in the narrow channel. Instead, a joint operation against the British garrison of 3,000 at Newport, Rhode Island, was planned by D'Estaing, would attack from the sea, while an American force under General Sullivan would invest the British from the land side. The French arrived July 29th, but Sullivan was not ready, as he had difficulty raising the necessary number of militia. By the time he was ready, Clinton had sent Admiral Howe's fleet to the aid of the besieged force. D'Estaing backed off to prepare for a decisive naval battle with Howe, but a fierce storm on August 11th scattered both fleets. The French then repaired their ships at Boston and sailed for the West Indies. Sullivan, without naval support, was forced to withdraw. Strictly speaking, from the colonial standpoint, there was no naval war during the Revolution. While several colonies maintained their own sea forces, America did not put a real navy at sea during the conflict, but instead made her influence felt on the sea lanes by an energetic and highly effective privateering fleet. Estimates of the number of American ships given letters of marque for privateering ranged as high as 2,000, the great majority of them commissioned by Congress. In the 8 years of the war, they captured some 600 enemy ships, taking an estimated $18 million worth of property. One privateer alone, the Rattlesnake, captured ships and cargoes totaling $1 million in a single cruise in the Baltic. In 1781, there were some 449 privateers actively engaged in combing the oceans for British shipping. Unfortunately, since the captured ships were sold in foreign ports and the officers and crews of the privateers divided the money and proceeds from sale of the cargoes, the American cause realized little from the program other than its nuisance value to the British and the moral uplift for the colonists at home. The real Continental Navy, such as it was, posed no threat to British naval might. There had been minor naval actions at Machias, Maine, in May 1775, and during the Siege of Boston, but the colonists did not actually commission a war vessel until Washington sent the Hannah to harass enemy supplies on September 2, 1775. 1 month later, Congress commissioned four warships. The Marines were given birth in November, and on the 25th, the Navy was finally established officially. Eight vessels were constructed, including the Hornet, Wasp, and Fly. Eskin Hopkins was named Commander-in-Chief, and the ranking lieutenant was John Paul Jones. Hopkins' first and only fleet action was the capture of Nassau, Bahamas, in March 1776. After that, Jones took the spotlight and held it for the rest of the year by capturing or sinking 22 enemy vessels. The French alliance brought a new fleet to the American coast, but enjoyed only frustration until 1781. Meanwhile, John Paul Jones continued to plague the British in his ship Ranger, actually raiding Whitehaven, England in April 1778, and later winning a militarily unimportant but spectacular and much publicized victory on September 23rd, 1779, when his new command, Bonhomme Richard, met and defeated the Serapis. There were a number of other equally glamorous encounters, particularly those of the intrepid Captain James Nicholson of the Trumbull and Captain John Barry's alliance, which fought the last real naval battle of the war in January 1783. However, none of these engagements had a very significant military impact on the war's outcome. By and large, the naval war was a sideshow, while the real issue was decided on land. Nevertheless, her victories at sea went far toward maintaining American spirit when the armies were retreating, and as well, they formed the basis of the American naval tradition for the time when the United States would be one of the great sea powers of the world. For all intents and purposes, the war in the North was now over. Washington later conducted a series of raids on British-held forts, and an expedition was sent against the Indians and Loyalists in western Pennsylvania and New York, but no major actions took place. An almost separate war, however, was taking place about this time in what was then called the Northwest. Most of the colonies had claims to the lands west of the Appalachians, but none of these were as extensive or as valid as Virginia's. Even as the Revolution was being fought, settlers had been traveling all over the Wilderness Road into Kentucky and Tennessee. But the British, with strong posts at Detroit and Niagara, had organized the Indians, enabling them to control the areas and to harass the frontier settlers. In December 1777, Governor Patrick Henry of Virginia met with Colonel George Rogers Clark and then proposed that the latter command an expedition against the lightly held British posts in the Northwest, then claimed by Virginia. The following May, Clark left Redstone Fort, Pennsylvania with some 200 men and floated down the Ohio on his way to the first objective, British-held Kaskaskia on the Mississippi. Clark invested the village on the night of July 4th, and the next day, the British surrendered to the Americans without the loss of life. Near Cahokia, it capitulated next. The French inhabitants of the region, upon learning of the French alliance, embraced the American cause, and through the efforts of the French priest, Father Gibault, the villagers of Vincennes pledged an oath to the new American flag. Lieutenant Governor Henry Hamilton in Detroit, upon hearing that Clark had wrested the Northwest from British control, prepared to regain the territory. On December 17, 1778, Hamilton, with a force of 500 British and Indians, descended upon Vincennes and recaptured the fort, Fort Sackville, and village. Word of Hamilton's sudden appearance at Vincennes reached Clark at Kaskaskia at a time when his forces were dangerously reduced by the expiration of enlistments. However, Clark soon learned that Hamilton, feeling secure for the winter at Fort Sackville, had reduced his own forces to only 80 men. Gathering 170 men, including French volunteers from the nearby settlements, Clark began his famous march, February 5th, 1779, against Vincennes, in heavy rains and across the flooded lands of the Wabash. Wading through ice water, often breast high, Clark's little army reached Vincennes on February 24th, 1779, and opened a deadly fire upon the gun ports at Fort Sackville, preventing the surprised British gunners from manning their pieces. The following day, Hamilton surrendered the post. Through Clark's brilliant maneuvering, the Northwest had been secured and the British power in the region driven back to Detroit. Unable to mount a successful drive from Canada and having failed in their efforts to take and hold the middle colonies, the British decided that a final attempt to crush the rebellion would be made in the southern colonies. This decision was influenced by the belief that a large number of loyalists would aid them, particularly in the Carolinas. As the first step in the operation, Clinton dispatched a force of about 3,500 from New York to Savannah, Georgia. On December 29, 1778, Savannah fell, and shortly thereafter, the British captured Augusta. Then they conducted a series of raids up and down the coast from Charleston to Florida. In the spring, Washington sent a detachment of Continental regulars under General Benjamin Lincoln to try to recapture Augusta, but Lincoln was defeated. The British, at last, seemed to be on the way to some significant success. But then, in June 1779, Spain declared war on England. And in September, D'Estaing arrived off Savannah with 35 ships and 4,000 French troops. Lincoln, with 1,400 men, joined the French and they besieged the city. But D'Estaing was impatient and October 9th ordered an assault on the strong British fortifications. The attack failed. The Americans suffered over 800 casualties and D'Estaing was wounded. He then sailed again to the West Indies. Heartened by this, Clinton now decided to use a major force to conquer the South, using Savannah at his base. He evacuated the garrison from Rhode Island and on December 26th, sailed from New York with over 8,000 troops, leaving about 10,000 in New York to keep Washington from making a counter move. The objective, once again, was Charleston, South Carolina. In December, Washington again moved his army of about 11,000 into winter quarters near Morristown, New Jersey. Even as the men set to work chopping down trees to build their crude log huts, the weather turned bitterly cold and one snowstorm after another howled through the area. Again, Congress did not send the needed supplies, and the men, suffered much without shoes and stockings and working half leg deep in snow. It turned out to be the worst winter of the war, and the troops suffered much more than they had at Valley Forge 2 years earlier. Spring finally brought some relief, at least from the weather, but it also brought bad news from the south. Clinton had arrived off the Carolina coast in February and had little trouble entering Charleston's harbor. The forts on Sullivan's and James Island had been allowed to fall into disrepair and were no longer tenable, and there was no artillery defense against an attacking fleet. Lincoln then made the fatal error of committing his whole force inside the city, and by early April, Clinton completed its investment. Unable to break out of the siege, Lincoln surrendered his entire force of about 5,000, including almost 2,000 Continentals. This was the greatest loss of Americans suffered during the entire war. Leaving Cornwallis to carry on the campaign, Clinton sailed back to New York, satisfied that South Carolina was securely in British control. In May, Washington almost had a mutiny on his hands. Two Connecticut regiments, tired of their pay being in arrears and having been without meat or decent food for several days, ignored their officers and demonstrated on the parade ground until they were disarmed by Pennsylvania troops. No violence occurred, and most of the men were pardoned, but it was a clear warning of what could happen if things did not improve. The year had started badly for the Americans, but that summer a new ray of hope appeared. In July, a new French force of 5,000 under the command of Count de Rochambeau with a naval escort arrived at Newport, Rhode Island. Washington was now hopeful that a combined attack could be made on New York, but Howe immediately sent a British fleet to blockade Newport. Without the necessary naval support, Washington had to abandon the idea. Still, the American forces were gradually growing stronger. More help was expected from the French, and if the British could be contained in the South, then the cause of freedom was still healthy. Congress appointed General Gates, the hero of Saratoga, to lead the attempt to contain the British in the South, although Washington had recommended Greene. Gates took command in North Carolina in July of an army of about 4,000, including almost 2,000 Continentals, detached from Washington, and started a slow march against the British supply base at Camden, South Carolina. On the morning of August 16th, Cornwallis, with a force of about only 2,400, surprised the Americans just north of the town. After a series of incredible blunders by Gates, the rebels were completely routed, many throwing away their arms in their panic-stricken flight, derisively called the Camden Races. Almost half the army was killed or captured, while many of the survivors simply disappeared. Belatedly following Washington's advice, Congress then relieved Gates and appointed Greene to command. With this defeat of the only large organized American force in the South, the way was open for Cornwallis's march north and the invasion of North Carolina. Three parallel forces moved northward in September. Cornwallis with the main force, Colonel Bonstre Tarleton commanding the feared British Legion Cavalry and Light Infantry, and Major Patrick Ferguson with 1,100 Tories, all Americans. Ferguson's mission was to protect the western flank of Cornwallis, crush the Patriots in western South Carolina, and rouse the backcountry Tories to British support. To the freedom-loving mountain people, Ferguson's mission and command were particularly galling. Not only was his force all Americans, but he was also protecting and recruiting other Tories. So the call went out, and soon a band of about 900 mountain yeomen, largely of Scotch-Irish descent, marched against Ferguson, and October 7th killed or captured his entire force at Kings Mountain on the border between the Carolinas, suffering fewer than 100 casualties themselves. Thus did a handful of mountain men turn the tide of the war in the South and break the Tory influence in the Carolinas for all times. The victory also halted Cornwallis' advance, forcing him to withdraw back into South Carolina. The British had once again lost an excellent opportunity to strike a decisive blow against the rebels. And with French aid building up, time was working against them. But Washington also had his troubles that winter. On January 1st, 1781, about 2,400 Pennsylvania Continentals encamped near Morristown. Finally fed up with no pay, food, or clothing, or allowances, mutinied against their officers and marched out of camp to present their justified grievances to the Congress in Philadelphia. Fortunately, the president of the Pennsylvania Executive Council was able to pacify them with promises of aid, but about half of them left the army anyway. A few weeks later, when several New Jersey regiments mutinied, Washington acted quickly and forcefully. He sent a force of 600 to disarm them and promptly executed two of the leaders. The war in the South was fast coming to a climax. When Greene took command in the Carolinas, he wisely realized that he was not strong enough to attack Cornwallis's main force. So he detached about 800 men under General Daniel Morgan to harass the British outposts in western South Carolina, while he tried to rebuild the army that had been shattered at Camden. Cornwallis was not anxious to advance against Greene with a rebel force operating on his western flank. So he sent Tarleton with about 1,100 troops to drive Morgan back against the main British army. Morgan, his strength now up to about 1,000 Continentals and militia, made a stand at Cowpens, once a cow pasture, on January 17th. And in a brilliantly led and executed battle, utterly routed the feared Tarleton, killing or capturing almost his entire force, and suffering fewer than 100 casualties himself. More important, however, this dramatic victory over regular British troops followed, as it did, the decisive defeat of the Loyalists at King's Mountain, raised patriot morale all over the country. The Southern militia began to turn out in the numbers needed, and reinforcements started to come from the North. Cornwallis himself now took out after Morgan, but the Americans eluded him, joined forces with Greene, and retreated across the Dan River into Virginia. Lacking boats and supplies, Cornwallis withdrew into North Carolina. Greene, now with some 4,000 men after getting reinforcements from Virginia, decided to go after Cornwallis, as he outnumbered him about 2-1. On March 15, they clashed at Guilford Courthouse in a desperate battle that the Americans almost won, until Cornwallis turned his artillery on both British and American troops engaged in hand-to-hand fighting. Greene withdrew, so Cornwallis claimed a victory, but it cost him over 500 casualties, about 25% of his force. As one English officer stated, another such victory would destroy the British Army. Too weakened to continue the campaign, Cornwallis retreated to Wilmington, but then decided that the Carolinas could never be secured while Virginia served as a supply and training base. So in April, he marched into Virginia. Instead of pursuing Cornwallis, Greene decided to leave the defense of Virginia to Washington and marched into South Carolina in an effort to regain control of the state. Although he could claim no victories in a series of engagements during the spring and summer, by fall, he had regained control of the area, with the lone exception of Charleston. Cornwallis, meanwhile, had been reinforced in Virginia. Benedict Arnold, the turncoat, who had earlier failed in his attempt to betray to the British the fort at West Point, New York, had been appointed to a command in the British Army. In January, he sacked and burned Richmond, and now joined forces with Cornwallis. With additional reinforcements under General Phillips, Cornwallis had over 7,000 men and raided freely throughout Virginia. Von Steuben, in command of the Virginia forces, was hopelessly outnumbered. Washington sent the Marquis de Lafayette with three regiments to Von Steuben's support. And in the face of this, Cornwallis decided to establish a base on the coast from which he could maintain communication with Clinton in New York. On August 1st, he arrived in Yorktown, closely followed by Lafayette and von Steuben. Here was a great opportunity, and Washington seized it. Joined by Rochambeau from Rhode Island and informed that a large French fleet under the Comte de Grasse was sailing for Virginia, Washington secretly began to move the bulk of his army south. Making a feint towards New York to deceive Clinton, he moved into Virginia. De Grasse arrived at the end of August, blockaded Chesapeake Bay, and landed his troops to join Lafayette. A British fleet under Admiral Thomas Graves tried to break the blockade on September 5th, but was defeated and withdrew to New York, abandoning Cornwallis. Washington arrived and with his allied army of about 16,000, laid siege to the town. Without access to the sea, the British were doomed, and Cornwallis knew it. On October 19th, with his band playing The World Turned Upside Down, he surrendered his entire army and wrote to Clinton, "I have the mortification to inform Your Excellency that I have been forced to give up the posts of York and Gloucester and to surrender the troops under my command by capitulation as prisoners of war to the combined forces of America and France." Ironically, on October 24th, Clinton arrived off the coast with 7,000 reinforcements, but on learning of the British surrender, sailed back to New York. Washington now urged a joint attack on New York, but De Grasse, pleading he was already overdue in the West Indies, refused to participate. Washington then marched northward to keep up the envelopment of New York, while Rochambeau spent the winter in Virginia, returned to his base in Rhode Island the following fall, and sailed for France in December. Cornwallis's surrender, combined with French victories in the West Indies in late 1781 and early 1782, convinced the British that they must sue for peace. In March, Parliament passed an act authorizing the Crown to start peace negotiations with the former colonies. In April, preliminary talks began in Paris with Benjamin Franklin, later joined by John Adams, John Jay, and Henry Lawrence. Formal negotiations commenced in September, and in November, the American representatives signed the preliminary articles of peace, ratified by Congress the following April. Although the official signing of the treaty did not take place until September 1783 in Paris. Due to the tenacity and stubbornness of the American peace envoys, the United States achieved its principal objectives: independence, adequate boundaries, free access to international waterways, the right to fish off Newfoundland and Nova Scotia, and the evacuation of British land and sea forces. The last British troops, now commanded by Sir Guy Carleton, sailed from New York that December. "It will not be believed," Washington wrote, "that such a force as Great Britain has employed for 8 years in this country could be baffled in the plan of subjugating it by numbers infinitely less, composed of men oftentimes half-starved, always in rags, without pay, and experiencing every species of distress which human nature is capable of undergoing. Sad to relate, their distress did not cease with their discharge. Congress gratefully voted each soldier a bonus of $80, but then had to issue certificates of IOU in lieu of money because of its destitute financial condition. Many of the soldiers sold their certificates for a pittance to speculators to help feed or clothe themselves on the way home. Most of them, however, left without the settlement of their accounts or a farthing of money in their pockets. They straggled home in groups, ragged and dirty, hungry, tired, and sick, begging meals at taverns and farmhouses, or stealing a chicken here or there. It was a bitter homecoming, and yet these veterans generally were not bitter. They were rugged individuals as well as individualists, and from their diaries and letters, it appears they were genuine patriots, well aware of what they had been fighting and dying for, with the astounding patience and fortitude to suffer through unbelievable hardships, until British blunders and French assistance gave them victory in the end. they had won, and in so doing, had accomplished the seemingly impossible. Whether they realized it or not, they were the instruments by which the great principle that men make governments was realized. The instruments by which the traditional belief in the divine right of kings was finally repudiated. Their commander-in-chief summed up for them the real meaning of what they had accomplished. The citizens of America, placed in the most enviable condition as the sole lords and proprietors of a vast tract of continent, comprehending all the various soils and climates of the world, and abounding with all the necessities and conveniences of life, are now, by the late satisfactory pacification, acknowledged to be possessed of absolute freedom and independency. They are, from this period, to be considered as the actors on a most conspicuous theater, which seems to be peculiarly designated by Providence for the display of human greatness and felicity. Here, they are not only surrounded with everything which can contribute to the completion of private and domestic enjoyment, but heaven has crowned all its other blessings by giving a fairer opportunity for political happiness than any other nation has ever been favored with, for which our faith will be the destiny of the unborn millions be involved. The world had indeed been turned upside down.